Hi. So, in this fifth lecture on unified approach, don't I will go a little bit to the, in my mind, the future directions using quantiles and expectiles. So let's firstly clarify what do we mean by quantile and connect it to the frontier production function model. So let us consider the multiplicative formulation of the frontier, like usually done in the stochastic frontier literature, where we have the single output and the multiple inputs and the composite error term consisting of inefficiency and noise. And so the quantile production function capital Q can be then defined as the product of the frontier production function and the inverse of the cumulative distribution function at point tau. So this parameter tau defines the order of quantile. So let us think about some alternatives that how would this this quantile production function then compare to the usual kind of production functions at different values of quantile tau. So if you set, for example, tau equal to 0.5, so then we come close to this idea of the average practice production function that that we considered earlier, that which we estimated with convex regression. So now we could think about this case with quantile tau as actually median production function, because then in that case it would be setting this value of the production function rescale to the median value of the composite error term. So it would come close to the average practice in the case of the tau equal to 0.5. So notice that we can think about this inverse of the cumulative distribution function as some kind of scaling of the production function F. If tau approaches to 1, then this quantile starts to approach this so-called full frontier. So then it becomes close to these deterministic frontiers like DEA or parametric programming case, where in fact we will then end up enveloping all of the observations. So it is quite trivial to show that the true stochastic frontier, so this true frontier F, could be then recovered by appropriate setting of parameter tau, so the order of quantile. And there are some recent papers that are trying to utilize this approach for estimating the frontier production function. However, my approach is slightly different. In some sense, by utilizing these quantile production functions, it allows us to actually avoid this question of where exactly the frontier is. So my objective is not really to try to find somehow some optimal tau, but rather I would consider a range of different tau or perhaps the entire spectrum of taus. And in some cases, that can be very, very interesting. So let me give you an example of this paper with Xun Shao, my former doctoral student, where we look at the marginal abatement cost of greenhouse gas emissions. So this is in some sense paving a way to the one of the future topics of modeling bad outputs. But never mind. So in this diagram, the horizontal axis is the greenhouse gas emissions indicated with the carbon dioxide emissions, and the application concerns power plants. So the vertical axis indicates the net generation of electricity as the desirable output. So you can think about this as some kind of frontier production frontiers. If you start from the full frontier case indicated by this light blue line, the topmost diagram, so that would be the special case of the DEA frontier, this kind of piecewise linear frontier that envelops all of the observations. So in this diagram, I haven't really indicated the observed data, but you can think about some kind of cloud of points that fall below this this light blue piecewise linear curve. And then we these series of quantiles indicated in this frontier, they we can start to decrease this value of tau from 0.95 to 0.85 to 0.75 and so on and so on. So you can, for example, interpret this 95th quantile as a curve that envelops 95% of observations and so on. And the lowest one, 0.05, so 5% of observations will be below this purple line indicated the fifth quantile. So this illustrates the idea that we can estimate not only a single average production function or frontier production function, but rather we can have an entire range of different quantiles. And very often people ask me, okay, why 10 quantiles, for example, as in this example? So my answer is always sort of pragmatic, that why not? We can have 20 or 50 or 1 million quantiles, any number that seems reasonable for the practical purposes. So notice that in this diagram, these 10 quantiles, they actually give quite a fine grid of different values. So for our purposes, it seems the 10 quantiles is quite enough, but in some other application, there might be 100 quantiles. So we do not need to restrict to any specific number of quantiles. We can compute as many as we want. So the main idea here with the use of different quantiles is we can then estimate for each observed data point the shadow prices separately. So when we are interested in the shadow price of the greenhouse gas emissions, what we essentially need is to find the slope of this quantiles. And our approach is to utilize the quantiles nearest to the observed data point. So rather than first projecting to this deterministic frontier and then looking at the slope of that blue line, we actually utilize the nearest quantiles for each observation, because we argue that the marginal abatement cost must be lower for the inefficient units, and it should be also, we should take this inefficiency into account in the marginal abatement cost. But that's another story. This was intended mainly to illustrate that how do these quantiles look like, and the main idea is not to just focus on the single frontier production function or average production function, but consider an entire spectrum of quantiles. And this can be useful, especially if we are interested in somehow the shape of these quantiles. We can also use it for seeing that is there some heteroscedasticity present in our data. And there are many, many potential applications. In fact, in many recent applications, we found this quantile approach very, very useful. And one reason why I particularly like the quantile approach is that we do not need to make any parametric distributional assumptions for the inefficiency and noise term, because we do not even try to estimate this where exactly is the frontier. We avoid that altogether by considering the nearest quantiles to the observed data point. So in that sense, I think it's a dramatically different approach to the frontier estimation, but this again calls into the question, okay, do we really need the frontier, or can we model the, is perhaps the quantile approach better solution than making some kind of strong parametric assumptions that are not really testable in the first place? So how do we estimate these quantiles in this kind of application situation? So the four Chinese authors, Wang Ji and Li, proposed the following kind of formulation that is similar to the convex regression problem that we have considered earlier. So I have here used the same notation that I used before in the convex regression, CNLS. However, notice that now this residual or the error term is divided in two parts. So I have epsilon minus and epsilon plus. So we should not directly confuse this epsilon minus and epsilon plus to the inefficiency and noise term, it might be kind of tempting to think about this epsilon minus as the inefficiency term and epsilon plus as the noise term, but that's not correct interpretation. Here it is just pragmatically epsilon minus captures any negative deviations from the quantile function, and epsilon plus captures any positive deviations from the quantile function. Notice that both epsilon minus and epsilon plus must be non-negative according to this last constraint. However, in the first constraint with this regression equation, we have negative sign for the epsilon minus and positive sign for the epsilon plus. So that's the idea of breaking down the deviations to the negative deviations and positive deviations. And notice that in the objective function, we then give a different weight to the sum of negative deviations and sum of positive deviations. So the sum of positive deviations is weighted by parameter tau, which corresponds to this quantile tau, whereas the negative deviations are weighted by 1 minus tau. So clearly, if we set tau equal to 0.5, so if we have the median curve, then there is equal weight to positive and negative deviations. Suppose then that we set this, increase the tau and set it somewhere close to 1. So suppose the tau is equal to 0.99. So that case, the objective function gives very heavy penalty for the positive deviations, whereas negative deviations have a low weight, because then the weight of the negative deviations would be 0.01 only. So therefore, the minimization of this weighted sum of deviations would tend to put virtually all observations below the frontier, because the negative deviations have a very small weight, whereas positive deviations are penalized very heavily. So we can show that as the tau approaches to 1, then this quantile production function approaches to the variable returns to scale DEA frontier. So this variable returns to scale DEA frontier is the limiting special case where tau approaches to 1. Notice that, however, tau cannot be exactly equal to 1, but it can be arbitrarily close to 1. So by setting different values of tau, solving this minimization problem, we can then estimate this multiple different quanta. So for each value of tau, we need to then solve this separately. So to shed further light, let us consider some properties for these quantiles. So let n plus indicate the number of observations that have strictly positive residual for given quantile tau, and let n minus be the number of observations with a strictly negative residual. Notice that some observations, of course, can have both e plus and e minus equal to zero. So in that would indicate that the observation is exactly on this quantile function for the given tau. I want to also point out that in the optimal solution, we will never have that both e plus and e minus would be same time positive. So one of them, either e plus or e minus, has to be zero, possibly both. So let's first consider the second property, which claims that as the sample size n approaches to infinity, then the share of observations with negative residual, so this ratio n minus divided by n, that's the share of observations with negative residual, that share is approaching to tau. In other words, this tau indicates the proportion of observations that are below the frontier. And correspondingly, the share of observations with positive residuals approaches to one minus tau. And then the property one gives some same result essentially, but with the inequalities. So in a finite sample for a given tau, then the share of observations with the negative residual is less than or equal to tau. And this inequality comes from the fact that there's also a possibility that some of the observations in finite sample are exactly on the quantile. So that's why it is inequality rather than equality. And as the sample size approaches to infinity, then the proportion of observations on the quantile frontier will approach to zero. So in that sense, the property number two also establishes consistency of the quantile function or this quantile estimator, that the proportion of observations that the quantile is enveloping approaches to tau as the sample size approaches to infinity. And these properties were formally also proved in this Wang et al. Paper that I cited before. However, there is one disturbing issue in this Wang et al. Formulation, in my view. Namely, because it can be solved by linear programming, it is possible that the optimal solution is not unique. It is possible that, for example, that we can increase the residual of one unit by decreasing the residual of another unit, and the optimal solution to the objective function is still unchanged. So the optimum is not necessarily unique in terms of the residuals. To avoid this problem, I have formulated this problem in a slightly differently in this paper that I have cited before. So this is the Squarsman and Johnson and Sastamoinen book chapter. So this is exactly the same quantile formulation that Wang et al. Proposed. However, we take now we raise these residuals in the objective function to power 2. So we minimize the weighted sum of squared residuals rather than weighted sums of residuals. So we have again this epsilon minus and epsilon plus components, but we use them to raise them to power 2 in the objective function. And this is also to draw a distinction to these quantiles. I have here indicated these weights tau by tau tilde to not confuse them to these quantiles tau. I come back to that point a little bit later. So this can be called an expectile regression. So it should be convex expectile and not quantile expectile regression. So it's convex expectile regression. And a couple of properties that are worth noting. So I think I mentioned it already with the case of quantiles that either this positive residual or negative residual has to be always equal to zero, possibly both. So that implies that the product of the positive and negative residual is always equal to zero in the optimal solution. So one of them has to be equal to zero, possibly both. Now, these parameters tau tilde, they are not exactly quantiles because it doesn't necessarily imply that they envelop certain number of observations, but we can show that this given tau tilde, even in finite sample, it's equal to the proportion of this negative deviations divided by the total deviations taken as the sum of the negative residuals and sum of positive residuals. So it doesn't necessarily measure the how many observations are enveloped, but it measures the sum of the residuals that are being enveloped. That is a subtle difference to the quantiles. So I want to mention that the expectiles are not exactly the same as quantiles. This is an illustrative figure from an article by New and Powell in Econometrica in 1987. And in fact, this term expectile was introduced by that paper. So they also do this kind of expectile formulation. So here, this mu tau curve refers to the expectile, and this eta epsilon curve is the corresponding quantile. And this refer to the standard normal distribution, not standard journal distribution, like the figure. This caption of the figure indicates. So there's some typo in the original article in this respect. Notice, of course, from this figure that if we take some given quantile, it is also possible to find the corresponding value of the expectile and vice versa. So it has been shown formally that there always exists a unique transfer function that can be used for converting quantiles to expectiles and expectiles to quantiles. So if you are interested in particular quantile, we can also estimate it indirectly using the expectile formulation. And there exist some studies in the parametric literature that suggest that the indirect estimation of quantiles using the expectile formulation can actually be more efficient in terms of the mean squared error. So we have done some simulations with Sheng Dai and Shun Shou to compare the performance of the expectile and quantile approach. So let me briefly share some intermediate results from these simulations. So briefly, the idea of Monte Carlo simulation is the following, that we take some known theoretical production function that we want to test our methods, and then we draw some random simulated data from this kind of data generating process, and we estimate the quantiles. So when we know the true quantile and we estimate it, we can see then how well our estimator performs, how well our estimator can capture this true quantile. So this can be used as testing these methods. So in this particular scenario, we have a case with two input variables, one output variables, and we've had sample size of 200 observations. And we have considered five different quantiles with the values of tau equal to 0.1, 0.3, 0.5, 0.7, and 0.9. So those are the rows in this table. And we have considered two performance statistics. So one is this MSE, mean squared error, that I mentioned before already. So this means we take our estimated value of quantile for some given data points, and we compare it to the value of the true quantile. We take the difference and take a squared value, and then we average over all observations and all multiple replications. I believe that there were 1,000 replications in each scenario. So this mean squared error gives us how far on average the squared value of this what is the squared difference between the estimated quantile and the true quantile. Again, in the simulated setting, we know exactly where the true quantile is located. The bias statistic is similar, except that we don't take the squared value, we take the difference. So the bias statistic then indicates that on average how far we are. So it can be positive or negative. So negative would mean that we underestimate the quantile, or positive would be overestimation. So here in this table, we can compare them using the expectile approach and the quantile approach. So the quantile would be this linear programming formulation by Wang et al. And the expectile would be using this quadratic programming formulation. And we have adjusted these tau hat weights in the expectile formulation to match the actually the tau, so these numbers are comparable. So a couple of interesting observations are worth noting from these simulation results. So both with the expectile and quantile formulation, the approach works best when we have the tau equal to 0.5, so when we estimate the median, when we give equal weight to the positive deviations and negative deviations. In some sense, it's intuitive that, of course, in the middle of the cloud of data, the cloud of point is thickest at in the middle, so to speak. So it's natural that then this quantile and expectile approaches perform best when tau is equal to 0.5. And the performance in terms of both mean squared error and bias tend to deteriorate as tau is approaching to zero or approaching to one. Another general observation that both quantile and expectile formulation, the bias tends to be positive when tau approaches to tau is less than 0.5 but greater than 0, and it tends to be negative when tau is greater than 0.5. So there is some kind of bias towards the median. And finally, if you are interested in comparing the direct estimation of quantile using the linear programming formulation versus indirect estimation using the expectile, notice that typically there is a quite notable benefit in terms of both mean squared error and bias in favor of the indirect expectile approach. Only for the very large value of tau in the case of 0.9, the direct quantile estimation seems to perform a little bit better. So these are the cases with the convex quantile and convex expectile regression. We could also use this kind of Monte Carlo simulation to test performance compared to the alternative approaches. So there has been a popular approach of so-called order alpha frontier estimation based on the free disposable Hall technology, which is covered in a large number of papers. And we can also then compare performance to that. But it's worth to note that in this quantile and expectile approaches discussed on this slide, we do assume that quantile frontiers are globally concave. So that is not something that order alpha estimator is utilizing. So we have then also compared to the situation with the where we relax concavity and we use the quantile with the so-called isotonic regression. So we can extend this Keshwari and Korsmanen approach to the quantile setting and estimate also with just monotonicity without concavity. So on the next slide, I will then indicate the results for the conventional order alpha method and the monotonic quantile, which doesn't rely on the concavity. So this table reports the mean squared error and bias for this order alpha method and monotonic quantile. Notice that this is exactly the same simulation setting, so we can also compare these mean squared error and bias figures to the previous slide. So in both cases, when we relax the concavity assumption, which actually is true, then performance deteriorates quite notably. So we do not get so precise estimates anymore when we relax concavity when it was actually true. In the case of this monotonic quantile, notice that it has a similar pattern as the concave quantile, that we have the best performance for tau equal to 0.5, and the performance deteriorates, so the mean squared error increases when tau approaches to zero, it approaches to one, when it deviates from the median. And also the bias, the sign of the bias behaves similarly, so it becomes negatively biased when tau is greater than 0.5 and positively biased when the tau is less than 0.5. And finally, if we compare our monotonic quantile approach to this established order alpha method, notice our quantile approach yields much, much better performance in terms of both mean squared error and bias. There's like huge difference in the mean squared error. Notice also that this order alpha is negatively biased, and this bias gets worse as tau decreases. So originally this order alpha was actually intended for improving robustness of the frontier estimation. So it's really geared to the situation where tau is relatively large. So 0.9 is perhaps the only reasonable case where this order alpha would make sense. And this for the values with small tau, this performance of order alpha is very poor compared to the quantile approach that we have considered. So this summarizes my discussion of the quantiles and expectiles, which I see as very promising way forward for the efficiency analysis or frontier estimation analysis. Without actually estimating any frontier, we can cover the spectrum of multiple different quantiles. And there are also many, many interesting ways forward to utilize it also in other than shadow pricing or estimating marginal abatement costs. So the next theme, number 5, then will be the modeling of contextual variables. And we come back to then this SFA and DEA techniques, as well as CNLS and STONED in that context.